Let's welcome Juan from Mexico. Okay, so good evening to everyone. I hope I'm not nervous enough to cut off all the time. I've been sitting here and being excited, especially when they say that I'm going to say something, right? So what is all about? So first, let me thank you. Thank you, all of you, for being here tonight. Thank you, Lance, for inviting me all the way to Israel, long ways from home. As you know, I live in Cancun, Mexico, which is in the eastern part of the country. I teach scuba diving. I get involved with a lot of people in diving, either in the ocean or mainly in the caverns, which is the main topic for this presentation. First, I would like to play a small video about the place where I'm from, and I hope you enjoy it, and then I continue with the presentation. The place I'm from, and as you know, some of you have been with us before, and I can tell there's some people in the room that I can call brothers, calzones. So very important for us is you get to know us very well. Our country has 125 million people on the whole country. Our main language is not English, it's Spanish. Even some people joke about what's the difference between Cancun and Miami, and we speak English. We have 69 languages or dialects in Mexico. The first or the main one is Nahuatl, which the Aztecs in the middle of the country used to speak. And then we have the second one is Mayan, which is the most alive. To this time, we have people who speak Mayan among the town, everywhere, is the reason why the Mayan language is the most alive in the whole country. Our primary income is oil, and after that, right after that, we believe in 10 years, tourism is going to be the first one. So we are people who have passion for customer service, and this I can tell you for sure. We just heard the presentation about Guadalupe Island on the Baja, which is 250 kilometers out of Ensenada, which we saw Boa's presentation, very nice done, and it's the best place in the world to scuba dive with white sharks. Simple as that. You have a 100 meters visibility. The animals are always there. Just last year they saw Deep Blue, which is the biggest white shark ever seen by people. All right. In Socorro Island. Socorro Island is, I can tell you, in the whole world, I've been in a few places in the whole world, Socorro Island has my favorite dive site, Cabo Pierce. It's a beautiful, beautiful dive site, and you will see this video. I know you all are scuba divers, and we like to see. We like to test what is that, and they are offering me, and what is that, and I wear it. You have to sell me the place where I want to travel, which I will do later on. Right now, I'm just talking about cenotes, which the topic is the hardest. Every time people ask me, doesn't matter, I've been there. I teach cavern and cave diving every day almost. And if you ask me, it's the hardest to explain. And the reason is, it doesn't matter how much I talk, how much I'll tell you. You won't understand until you see it. You will get on it and say, is this the place where I'm going to dive? Really? This is a small place? But when you come out of that dive, you probably will say, this is one of the best dives I ever done. And I have some people here to back me up. All right, so let's continue letting you with the story of what a cenote is. 66 million years ago, a meteorite hit Earth. And guess what? Out of all the countries, it hit Mexico. There is a theory about how the dinosaurs died, 75% of the life on Earth. And one of the theories, it blames this meteorite, which hit Chicxulub, the Yucatan Peninsula, all right? And this is one of the craters that are confirmed to be true. In the 1970s, they found gravity anomalies. They found shock quartz and other reasons why and how they confirmed it. It wasn't not confirmed in the 1990s, but a couple of Mexicans and one American who was looking for oil or pemmics in the peninsula. This is some information about the confirmed craters on Earth. The biggest one confirmed is in South Africa. We have the Canadian one, 300 kilometers diameter. That's how big they are. The one in Chicxulub, the one you see on the third plate here in Yucatan, is 180 kilometers wide and 25 kilometers deep. Obviously, to this time, some people will ask, I know, can I go and see it? After all those years, Earth did its work and it covered most of it. But there is information. Something very important about this is all these yellow points around this crater is where most of the cenotes are. Most and the deepest cenotes or sinkholes were there. When this happened, when this meteorite hit Earth, all that debris, all that ashes and all that went to the sky. It can't get to the space, there's no air there, so it starts covering the Earth, and we couldn't get any sun. So we fall into an ice age. That ice age stopped light, and the Earth fall into an ice age, temperatures drop down, the North and South Pole freeze, the Earth, or the ocean, drop down 100 meters from what we have right now. To this day, how we know that? People will say, you are full of it. How can you dare to tell me that the we have an ice age and the ocean was below? Because these formations, it's impossible for these formations to grow up if they were flooded. So when you can dive, some of you have been there, and you can see these speleothems. Speleothems is the name of the formation. There is hundreds of names like stalactites, stalagmites, ear, elephant ears, needles. There's so much there then only if you are a geologist. I don't know if you have a geologist. If you are, I'm sorry. I'm trying to do my best, but this is what happened, and you get to see it. Some are in the cavern, and some are in the cave, which we will see what is the difference between a cavern and a cave, and who can dive where. In a few minutes, I'll let you know, but it's sometimes those rooms are fully decorated with formations and speleothems. All right, and in the Yucatan Peninsula, we don't have any altitude. That glass, that meteorite, it wipes out every single hill or mountain. If you've been in Yucatan or you've been in Cancun, that area, even the southern part of the United States and Florida, it doesn't have any mountains. It's flat. And the reason is because all that power, plus everything, so it's flat. I think the altitude in the peninsula is 35 meters above the sea level. So that's very, 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 very low. We can't build in Cancun. If you go, there's a few buildings that are not very high because it's very hard to build the underground lakes for architecture. They are very soft. Most of the rock there is limestone. Limestone is very soft. It's very, very, very complex to build anything like skyline or anything like that. So in other parts of the world, this is how they grow. Like to this day, if you go to Colorado, that's how they grow. The water flows from altitude with the gravity all the way down, and it filters. Normally, the water will absorb CO2 from the air, and it becomes acid. That acid water will help the process of carving the rock, either on trees or plants, all the way down. So you have some dry caves. And you will have, in our case, underwater caves. All right? Let's look into it. This is the process. So when that meteorite stopped the light, it froze, and all that rain, it falls into the soil, absorbed the CO2 from the air, and then the soil, it found its way down and started growing. On those aquifers, the water has to go somewhere. They were underwater in these big aquifers or pools, pits, but they had to move. As you know, there is the Coriolis effect, where the water at the north part of the globe moves clockwise. In South America, South Africa, it goes counterclockwise. So that water has to move. It couldn't get stuck in one place. So you start carving tunnels on the ground, especially if they are shallow. The limestone is very permeable. So the water travels down very easily. It doesn't contain many states in Mexico, which we have 32. They have problems with water in the state. Our state, Quintana Roo, which is the peninsula of Yucatan, has three main states, which is Campeche, Yucatan, and Quintana Roo. Quintana Roo is the richest in water in the whole country. Normally the politicians will come and say, I promise you're never going to run out of water, always in Quintana Roo. So this is what you're going to find a lot. The formations are there either in dry caves or underwater caves. So you're gonna get to see a little bit more of it. We're going to move into the cave. That's how they were formed, how they grow. The cavemen used to live there. How we know that is because people or remains of people been found in Mexico, in that peninsula. Just about 3 years back, some explorers found remains of a woman, which is called Naya. In the beginning, they didn't know if it was Mayan, if it was 5,000 years old, if it was three. Some explorers this is the picture of National Geographic grabbing the remains. They grabbed it and they did a C14 test to find out how old that was, and it was, it became 12,000 years, which is the oldest in the whole continent in America. So they find out, if you see this side of the screen, they found this woman in 30 meters and she died because she fell. Right beside her, it was other remains of other creatures. In this case, we found different animals. You can dive. Some of you dove in places where if you dive on the cave, you find remains of a sloth, a giant sloth. You have tiger saber tooth. You have mammoths there. There is a museum right now. They are the first of its kind because it's not easy to find just remains everywhere. But this is what they were and how they were used by people before. Now, about 1,200, 1,500 years back, we have a young civilization compared to this area. We have the Mayan civilization, and they base their whole civilization, the whole culture around cenotes. Cenotes were very important for them. Why? Because they need to survive. That even they build their cities on top of cenotes or water, fresh water. And the reason is because they need it. They couldn't transport it. The jungle in the Yucatan Peninsula is so dense they can't transport water from one place to another. Right now, if we're thirsty, we can ask for a bottle or a glass of water. Simple as that. But how are they going to transport that? How are they going to move the water? So they build the whole civilization around cenotes. Their deities were there. They believe if it gives me life, it also gives me death. So the cenote is not Spanish. It's a Mayan word. It means water source, which some people will say, if I want to dive in a cenote, it has to be a cavern, or it has to be a cave. No, we have, in this case, this is Casa Cenote, which is near to Tulum. People do the open water course here. When the weather is bad, we bring the people here. Why? There's no waves. It's just 100 meters from the ocean, and it's all fresh water. It has some salt water. In reality, right underneath this picture, there's a siphon, which sucks the water, and it comes out in the ocean. This is how people use the notice to this day. But the Maya civilization have a big problem. 1,200 years back, they have a big drought. You know how the scientists grow drill and get a piece of ice and grow it? They can tell how the weather was thousands of years back. They did the same with the rock. And they find out 1,200 years back, they have a big drought. The Mayans have a big drought, 25 years of no rain. Can you imagine how the water dropped down? Very, very low. So they start suffering. They start suffering for it. Because they have a seed, they have cities. If you or me or a small family of three or four or five people find a little pond of water, a little cenote, you can live out of that. But how are you going to give water to 100, to thousands of people who live in Chichen Itza? They suffer a lot. So they start giving these offerings. This is a real picture I took from a real ceramic. So last people touched this thing, it was a real mine. So it was very interesting. I worked with archaeologist Guillermo de Anda, which is the only Mexican is recognized by National Geographic. In this case, there are some remains. These remains are not cavemen. These are from the colonia, from the church and the Mayans when they tried to colonize. These are big stories, and they are only them for to tell. Sorry. So they suffered. They start giving ceramics, and things didn't get better. So what they start doing is they start putting remains in some sacred cenote. Not everyone has access to cenote. They kept it. Very, very jealous about it, so they need permits or only certain people could access to them. But in this case, This is the archaeologist, and this is one of the places we found. Again, this is the main reason why the people in Chichen Itza left the city. Now, there's a lot of theories about the aliens came and took them away with them because they were so good with the astronomy, with the architecture. That didn't happen. The truth is they couldn't live in the city because they didn't have water. They didn't have water forever.
You are mic off. You have to talk to the microphone.
Sorry. Okay. So, at the end, they have to leave the city. They went away. That's why, in the beginning, I said the Mayan is the most alive language after Spanish in Mexico, because they are around. They didn't left. They are everywhere. They are everywhere in that peninsula of Yucatan. And what is interesting to us, or the reason why we're here, is because scuba diving, right? We all want to see where am I going to use this, where can I dive. Like I said before, there is cenotes are used for snorkeling. There is people who can be not diving and be on these cenotes and enjoy it, like the ones you saw, Casa Cenote. Very friendly, you can dive. There's kayaks, there is even paddle boats now. And the cavern is used by scuba divers. They do trips, they do courses. And they are very unique. There is no other place on earth that you can find this. There's expeditions, and obviously, most of you will ask, is there any life? Am I going to find a shark? Am I going to find a turtle or a moray eel? Most of the life on these caves are isopods or crustaceans, small animals that are, 10 centimeters or 20 millimeters. It's very, very small place. There's some cenotes that will have freshwater turtles. There's catfish, some eels, and blackfish. Especially inside the cave, you're going to find this type of life with no color because of the lack of light. But this is what you find mainly. Also, outside of that, in the water, outside of the water, you will find bats. There's no caves without bats. You are not going to find Batman, but definitely you're going to see some bats. The people who dove with us, I'm sure they remember, they were hanging hundreds of them on a few places. Also, they are part of the ecosystem. They help. It's not because we don't want to scare them. They eat the insects, mosquitoes. They help the disease. They get all those mosquitoes, so they are good for the community. And there is a notice that will tell you, don't kill the mosquitoes. And probably it's not because of the mosquitoes, but it's because of the bats. All right, so also they are part of the food chain. You're going to find some snakes hanging, in not everywhere, especially where we dive. They are very, very, very recreational. But there is some caves away from the coast, and you find there's people who will pay to see hundreds of the snakes hanging with the thousands of bats going out. Obviously, not us. I'm not. People like to see other stuff. So we're going to continue. And the difference. Now, what is the difference between a cenote, a cavern, and a cave? A cenote, like I said, it can be any source of water. It can be on the surface. It can be underground. And they have different ages. The age depends on the size of the entrance. The bigger they are, the older they are. Because what it means they are old and the column collapse. So as it rains, the water carves that entrance and make it bigger. What is a cavern is 60 meters from the entrance. As long as you can see the light of the sun. Sometimes you are diving and you don't see any light, but if you turn around, you will see the light of the sun. That's a cavern. Now, if you come back to the same place at night, a few hours later, and there's no light, you come back 8 o'clock at night, that's not a cavern. That's a cave. The cave is the tunnel that goes in, and it's only for technical divers. People who get trained, like on the right-hand side picture, will be trained, and it's a lot of training. People all over the world consider cave divers as the best in the world. The reason is because they work on confined spaces, they use rebreathers, they use side mount, back mount. They all go there and like to explore. So that's a different type of diving, which we're going to talk about in a few minutes, which is right here. We find cave diving is the most dangerous sport on earth, but it's not that dangerous. The thing is, people like to get in the cave without training. The most important rule in cave diving is you have to be trained, you have to have the right equipment, and the right procedures. So there's been, even if, when you are diving in the cavern, right at the end of the cavern, some of you saw some signs and says, don't get in here, and I don't want to say what else it says, but it says it's very dangerous for you. So you shouldn't get there unless you are cave training. There is cave training with doubles, like I said before, side mount. There's courses of side mount specialized for cave diving. I know you, some of you are side mount divers, and you dive with side mount in the ocean. There's a special procedures on caves. Also, side mount rebreathers. 80% of the caves in Mexico, they are small. They have restrictions. A restriction means then a diver will have to pass through a small or narrow place. So most of the cave divers in Mexico, they become now full side mount divers because they needed to access these beautiful places. There's expeditions. Expeditions means people are exploring. There's a lot of exploration in Mexico, and the reason is because they steal a lot of remains. We have over 7,000 cenotes and haven't been explored or discovered. So people, you know, you get there and you can spend 2 or 3 years of your life trying to put lines on a cave, trying to draw a map so everybody can join. It's very, very excited, very, very exciting. Also, archaeology is very big. The country has very few underwater archaeologists, and we need more. That's as simple as that. So this is only for technical divers. And now I want you to look into this small video I played. This, I'm going to have three videos. This is the first one of them. And some of you that are in this room are in this video.
Thank you.
you saw the size of those formations. There's some very big ones. Just very important for us is the conservation. Conservation when we take people. We always give them a full briefing about the dive, the special procedures like the kicking, the buoyancy, and it's all because the conservation. This place has been there for thousands of years, growing, developing, and we are very concerned about the conservation of cenotes. It makes a very good relationship with the owners. Those cenotes are not owned by the country. There's the water is the country, but the land, it belongs to someone. So we always have a good relation with them. This is what a cenote, what cavern, and what cave diving. But there's not only that. What you have in the area is 4 hours of hotel, 4 hours of diving, different types of diving. You have Isla Mujeres, which is an island, 6 kilometers right in front of Cancun. They are right next to each other, which is very much the same. You have Cancun, you have Playa del Carmen, and Cozumel, also, as we talk, the Cenotes. Each one of these places offers something different. Cancun, we'll play this little video about Cancun. It's very hard to compete with the types of diving you guys have in the ocean. The truth is, it's very hard. But there are some special things, and you will like it, like whale sharks. We have hundreds of whale sharks. I don't know if you guys remember, but when you get in the water, it's not one or two. Sometimes you see hundreds of them together, so you can snorkel, right? In season also, we have bull sharks. Bull sharks in Playa Carmen, which are considered one of the best dives with sharks in the world. It's been developing some problems with fishermen in conservation, because once you start playing with them, there's a lot of people who are looking for what Boss just did. Just he gives you just like a briefing about fins, how they fisher, how they go out and fish all the sharks. So also we have to be careful. Sometimes the government is trying to protect them, but the divers wants to dive with them, and the fishermen are also involved. So we have to be very aware of these things. Cozumel is always there, always nice. The visibility is over 40 meters, 50 meters. Water is warm. So very much, that's what I have to say about the area. It's very long. You can go and dive in the same day in Cancun, and then dive in a cenote and a wreck dive. I will have this small video about Cancun. Many people don't know that there's any diving in Cancun. And the reason is the country spends $5 million trying to convince everyone that it's only in Cozumel. So they're not going to try to convince you, oh, and we have diving in Cancun too. But the dives in Cancun have very, very good life, particularly in winter. Let me play this video for you. And this is on a wreck. In a wreck, 25 meters, about 30 meters, 25 to 30 meters underwater. And this is in winter time, right out of Cancun, which is Eagle Race. This Eagle Race, if you can see the wreck, is over here. And every time, even they are like movie stars. They know you're coming, and they will come and post you. They take a picture. Okay, it's fine. I'll let you do that. And sometimes when they are not in the mood, they're eagle, right? So sometimes they come, and then if you go and try to chase them and take a photo, they will swim away, and then will come back. Or you know, go for a tour and come back. They are very grateful. And it's everything is within Cancun, which also in Cancun, you have everything. You don't have to come only if you are not a diver. If you are not very experienced, we have all types of diving. You don't have to be super advanced. You don't have to be a cave diver only, or you don't have to have 200 or 300 dives or 1,000 dives to be able to go there. It's kind of simple. So, also, people is looking for entertainment. They are looking for nice sunny beaches. They are looking for malls, shopping malls. The whole place is full of Mayan rings. You have Chichen Itza, Cubas, Ulum. They are full of other parks, like Eco, this one over here in the middle, zip lines and ATVs. You can go in the jungle, like you saw boas, having some fun. He crashed a couple cars over there. They're looking for boas. So it's not only about diving. It's the whole area is very, very friendly, and it's full of, I would say, the whole country, out of the tourism we were talking about, the main destination is that state. 90% of the taxes for the government and goes to them in tourism, it comes from this state. And this is the reason why. You have everything on the same area. I mean, we were not that lucky, but the only thing we need is Guadalupe and Socorro on that side, and then we can get off the rest of the country. We can keep only that peninsula. But the truth is, you know, Mexico is very big. It's from Tijuana, which Boss was telling you, you can fly into it if you want to go to the White Sharks, to Cancun is 4,300 kilometers. So if you are driving, you can imagine you can spend a whole week trying to get to the other side, which you can reach within 3 hours flight. All right, so I came here very humble, just trying to share what we do, and what Wild Dive is telling you, then we can do for you. Obviously, it doesn't matter how good you think you are. At the end of the trip, we are giving a service. So I will leave you before the last video with this little phrase that says, "I have learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you make them feel." And that's very important for us because we travel too. We are divers. We travel to the Red Sea and we like to get a good service. We like to get the best dives. We like to visit the best places you can do, and that's what we do. If you have fun, we probably have fun too. So I'm going to leave you with the last video before I handle the microphone back to Milan. I hope you guys like it.
okay. Someday I'm gonna be with you. It's okay. I know someday I'm gonna be with you. It's okay. I know someday I'm gonna be with you.
Someday I'm gonna be with you. It's okay.